to page 1884. He talks about having perspective in the Christian faith.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be blessed by you, O Lord. In the name of Jesus our Lord. Amen. There's a research group called the Barna Group. It's a Christian group that surveys just Christian population to get an idea of what we believe and what we do. And a recent survey was made, and they asked, is God who helps those who help themselves from the Bible? 80% of them said, yep, but it isn't. Just like we found here with Ralph. That sleeping dog's lie. That's not in the Bible. Nor is God helps those who help themselves. But more than half of them also said that they strongly agreed with the opinion that this is a major theme of the Bible. Well, there are many sayings or proverbs people think are in the Bible. The fact is sometimes they have a biblical ring to them. But this sermon deals with the truth and the falsehoods of that statement that God helps those who help themselves. And even though it isn't in the Bible, the saying provides us with the opportunity to reflect upon what it does say, because some of the saying, that saying is true and some of it is false. Let's take a look. Christians are supposed to help themselves. Well, God has given us gifts to use in our lives, and Jesus wants us to use them. He said, you shall worship the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. One of the ways we can do this is by being good stewards of ourselves. I never thought about that. We have a stewardship program, and when fall comes around, that's when we're usually used to hearing stewardship messages. But the fact is that God wants us to be good stewards of ourselves year-round. If bodies and minds are the living temple of God, as the scripture tells us, then we need to take care of that temple, take care of ourselves. Many of the instructions in the Old Testament that are meant to protect us from foodborne illnesses are there. They tell you may not eat this or eat that. That's because they were desert people and they had no refrigeration. And often the food they had was in danger of causing illness in them. But today there's so many other ways we need to care for ourselves. We're reminded of what beneficial foods to eat and which ones to avoid. And the ones that don't provide good health are to be put aside. And we're reminded to exercise regularly, to be sure to develop friendships that offer important support to us and give us vital interaction with others. We're told to recognize things for which to be thankful, because that gives us a positive view of life. And so we're to help ourselves. We're to be good stewards of the life that God has given us. And God has given us brains and strength and imagination and wisdom to make that possible. Another component that gives us that strength is the study of Scripture. It gives us perspective, as James's passage did in the New Testament. And of course, there's prayer that keeps our relationship with God alive. Our friends, the Roman Catholic Benedictine Order, has a motto. It's in Latin, ora et laboro, and it means prayer and work. Pray and work. Now, that's the combination that enables us to be good stewards of ourselves. Pray and work. And in turn, it enables us to be good servants of Jesus Christ, to be God's people. Well, it's not an either or. It's not either pray or work. Work or pray. It's both. For example, if you're unemployed, it's important to pray for a new job. But you and I know that prayer doesn't provide the job, because you just come out of heaven. Hustle is necessary, as many of you have found. There's a resume to be prepared, networking to be developed, active scouring of ads and journals for positions, that's important. Preparing for interviews and going to them, none of these can be neglected. But sitting at home and praying and not working on it at all doesn't work. We have to accompany prayer and then let God show us the way. Pray and work, says the Benedictines. That's wisdom for us. Now, we have sympathy for unemployed, no doubt. And some of you are thinking, well, there are other things that are said. For instance, doesn't the Bible say, the one who is unwilling to work shall not eat? If you don't work, you don't eat. Yeah, you may remember that. The fact is, that's in the book of James as well. The circumstances were very different, though. The people in the congregation at Thessalonica in Greece believed that Christ's return was imminent any day. I mean, not months away, weeks maybe, but more likely hours. And so some of them believed that since Jesus was coming very soon, hey, why work? Just lounge around and wait. And if fellow Christians are good enough to give you food, drink, and a place to stay, all the better. That's why James says, it doesn't work that way. However, sometimes God helps those who help themselves is used as an irresponsible way to get off the hook when it comes to helping others. It's then that it becomes, let them take care of themselves. And when we say that, we're ignoring the countless reminders that we're to be neighbors to one another. And we are meant to be our brother's keeper. It's the neighbor who stops to help the man on the road. A Samaritan man who stops and helps. He was the neighbor, Jesus says. And again in the scriptures, we're enjoined to take care of widows and orphans. And when we ask, who are those in need? We're talking to those who are in desperate circumstances and genuinely need assistance to get through. Now, there's another sense in which God helps those who help themselves that is not true. We cannot help ourselves get out of the bind of sin. It doesn't work. We can pray all we want to say, Lord, take our sin away. We can pray all we want to say, Lord, I'm in a real bind. I don't have a decent relationship with you. No. The fact is, we can't do that. We can't accomplish that on our own. There's a quote once that stuck in my mind, and it says, sin is the infection, and the things we do, the sinful things we do, are the symptoms. We know those symptoms well, we include them in our prayer and confession, but we're infected with this disease called sin, and we can't wish it away, we can't earn it away, we can't pray it away. There's only one way to get rid of it, and that's the fact that God has to take it away. And that God does for us in Jesus Christ on the cross. And so the fact is, God only can forgive our sin, and it's called grace. Grace is nothing we can earn, nothing we can labor for, nothing we can bargain for. It's God's free gift, and like every free gift, you have two choices, to accept it or to reject it. When grace is given to us, we gain a new sense of worth. Find out who we are. We have a new sense of gratitude in our lives. Look what God has done for us by taking away that infection called sin and restoring our relationship with God. It makes us stronger people. It makes us more confident people. It gives us a better sense of what God wants us to do and be. Well, no. God helps those who help themselves is not from the Bible. In fact, it was a common saying 5 centuries before Jesus was born. That was in Greece. And then it was dormant for a number of years until Ben Franklin came along with his work, Poor Richard's Almanac. In 1736, he revived it. And he put a one-liner in that almanac that says, God helps those who help themselves. And so it all began again. And there are times when we can help ourselves, and we should. There are other times when we need help. And Christians are noted for being compassionate and caring and supportive and give the help that is desperately needed. And so that's what it's all about. There are times when we cannot help ourselves and need to trust God to give us that much needed grace, that forgiveness of our sin, which only God can help us do. And there are times when God's people are called into action to help those who cannot help themselves. And in the meantime, we're to be good stewards of ourselves, to use all the gifts God has given us to take care of ourselves, that we may be worthy servants of Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Lord, not all the questions of life are easy. This is one of the difficult ones. But we thank you for whatever insight we have received this day from your word. Come to us, Lord, as those who have been those who have received help. Give us compassion for those who need help. And for all of us, we give thanks to you, O God, for the gift of grace of sin forgiven, found on the cross by our risen Lord. Amen. Amen.